He called the Secret Service agents who walked with Rebozo and Nixon on the beach in San Clemente, and he said, what do you hear when they take the walks on the beach? And the Secret Service agent goes, it's the damnedest thing. They don't talk.
I'm really excited today to have Gary Ginsberg with us. I met Gary when he worked at the News Corporation and the Murdoch Empire and its various iterations. He also worked at Time Warner and at SoftBank. So he's had a long career kind of in and around the media world. He spent time in the White House during the Clinton administration. And so it's a lot of history, you know, politically as well as in business, and has a real perspective, you know, kind of in those two worlds. And so we're obviously here to talk a bunch about the book that Gary just wrote called First Friends. And so we're going to spend most of the time on that conversation today. And it's our pleasure to have you. And thank you very much for being
here. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so let's start just talking about what prompted you to actually think about writing a book of this nature.
Well, since I was in the third grade, I've been fascinated by the American presidency. It was actually a sixth grade play on the assassination of Abraham Lincoln that got me captivated. Now, why the faculty thought the assassination of Abraham Lincoln would be the proper entry point for a third grade class, I don't know. But I just came back from that play just transfixed by the presidency. And as I got older, I started to get involved in presidential politics. I worked for the Gary Hart campaign in 1984. And during that campaign, I really took special note of a friend of Gary Hart's named Warren Beatty. Now, you probably remember Warren Beatty. A lot of you who are younger won't, but he was the most famous actor in Hollywood. Yeah. And he would fly in for Gary Hart's most prominent campaign events. And he would talk to him in a way that nobody else around Hart could. He'd say, stop talking and acting like a politician, Gary. And Hart would just kind of be jarred because he was talking to him in a way that staffers couldn't, because staffers needed, you know, the relationship with the candidate to keep their job. Warren Beatty didn't. He didn't owe anything to Gary Hart. Gary Hart didn't owe anything to him. They had this relationship that transcended, you know, position and authority. And so I watched this, and I was really fascinated by the uniqueness of that relationship, and also how he would go out to dinner with him late at night and relax him in a way that no staffer or aide could. Fast forward 8 more years, I worked for Bill Clinton, and I see the same dynamic at play with someone I think you knew, Vernon Jordan, who also had equal stature to Governor Clinton then and could speak to him and act with him in a way that nobody else could. And so I kind of took this mental note of this role of the first friend, and I started looking around at literature to see what was written about the first friend, because it was sticking in my head. There have been books about first wives, first sons, first butlers, first chefs, first decorators, but nothing about the first friend.
So you explore 9 first friendships in the book. Just give us a perspective on how you chose the 9, the research that you went through, you know, how that kind of came together.
Well, I knew I wanted to do Bill Clinton because I had worked for him, and I knew I wanted to do Vernon Jordan. In fact, when I first came upon the idea of the book, the first call I made was to Vernon in 2018, and I went and saw him at Lazard. And we sat down, and he said, listen, Gary, I ended my memoir, Vernon Can Read, in 1992, because I'm going to tell the story of my friendship with Vernon, with Bill Clinton, not you. And I said, I got it. You know, I won't obviously use any of this. Of course, I went back to my office and everything down. Unfortunately, Vernon got quite sick about a year and a half ago and passed away, unfortunately, in March. But I did call Bill Clinton, and I told him about the book. He was really interested. I said, can you tell me who your first friend is? He said, I need some time to figure it out because he's got so many. Called back and said Vernon Jordan. So I obviously did that chapter. And he was the only president for whom I could ask the question. I knew I wanted to do Kennedy. So I called his daughter, Caroline, who is an old friend of mine. And I asked her, I said, who's your father's best friend? And I was expecting the obvious names of Lem Billings or Ben Bradley. But she gave me somebody I'd really never heard of, and I'm a bit of a student of her father's presidency, a guy named David Ormsby Gore. Mm. And I think it was the most interesting choice. It's somebody that is kind of lost to history, but if you read the chapter, which I hope you will, you'll see that he was not only, I think, Kennedy's closest personal friend at the end of his life, but also his most important foreign policy advisor, and he was a British citizen. He was the British ambassador to the United States. So it's a big revelation. It's gotten a fair amount of play from people because I think it's just somebody that nobody had expected. Some were total surprises to me, like Nathaniel Hawthorne, the author we've all been subjected to in life, you know, with the Scarlet Letter, who was actually best friends with Franklin Pierce. He's the only pairing where the friend is more famous today than the president. Some were just, you know about Thomas Jefferson, you know about James Madison, but I didn't know that they were such great friends for 50 years and made history through their friendship. Some I knew, like Joshua Speed and Abraham Lincoln. Some I also knew, like Eddie Jacobson, who convinced, if you go to Hebrew school in the 70s, as I did, you learn about Eddie Jacobson, who convinced Harry Truman to recognize the State of Israel. And one I grew up with, which was Bebe Rebozo and Richard Nixon, and I was always fascinated by that.
Okay, good. All right, so let's go through some of these.
Sure.
Let's go through Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah.
You talk about the, and you mentioned it, the Jefferson-Madison collaboration and how consequential it was in American history. Just give us a perspective on that.
Yeah, I think it was the most important friendship in American history. I know that's a big statement, but I think it was. It spanned 50 years from 1776 until Jefferson died in 1826. It encompassed 1,250 letters between the two of them, some running as long as 17 pages, some as short as a page, but I mean, an extraordinary body of work between the two.
No texting.
There was no texting. And, and often it would take weeks, if not months, particularly when Jefferson was in Paris, for them to communicate. But it was, as you used the word collaboration, it was as much a collaboration as it was a friendship. It was two force fields coming together. They were very different men.
How did they get to know each other?
They met in the House of Commons in Virginia. Jefferson was 2 months shy of writing the most famous document in American history. Madison was a 25-year-old sickly kid from Virginia. He was a child prodigy, graduated from Princeton in 2 years. He slept 5 hours a night, and he got really sick as a result, but he was a genius. So they meet in the House of Commons. Here you have this dashing, personable, brilliant man in the form of Thomas Jefferson, and you have this little guy, he's 5'4", Little Jimmy is his nickname. He doesn't say a word, but they ultimately become quite friendly when Madison becomes a member of what was called the Council of Advisors to the governor, when Jefferson's governor in the late 1770s, and all of a sudden Jefferson recognizes Madison's genius. He is a real quiet genius. And what they realize is they each need each other because they're very different, not only in terms of physical bearing, but also in terms of personality. As I say, Jefferson was larger than life both in body and in personality. Madison was not only very quiet and timid and small, but he was also afraid to assert himself. And so they played off of each other. Jefferson needed Madison's exacting mind and his practical nature, and Madison needed Jefferson's big, bold personality and idealism. And they both fed off of that to create what I think are the most important, I mean, their friendship, if you really stop and think about it, resulted in the basic structures of our United States government today. The Constitution, because Madison got all of his intellectual grounding from gifts that Jefferson sent to him from Paris in the late 1780s. He sent him dozens and dozens of books on political philosophy, history, also gadgetry that Madison became really interested in science, and so he was sending him things to feed his scientific interests. But he really gave him the intellectual grounding to become the foremost thinker and constructor of our Constitution. And then when Jefferson hears from Madison about what's in the Constitution, he complains and says, we need a Bill of Rights. And Madison is dead set against it. And they go against each other for about a year and a half. But only because of their friendship and the respect that they have does Madison ultimately come around to the view, yes, we do need a Bill of Rights. And a Bill of Rights gets ratified with the Constitution in 1789. We are also the two-party system. Totally a result of their friendship, which you have to read in my book to appreciate. But we would not have had a second party but for this collaboration of these two men. The state university system, purely a function of their friendship. They both worked toward the creation of the University of Virginia after they both left office, when Madison left office in 1817. And then they spent the next 9 years working on the development of the University of Virginia. So many things that we take for granted today came as a result of that friendship.
All right, let's go to Lincoln and Joshua Speed, who I believe fundamentally had disagreement on slavery.
He did.
And yet Speed was instrumental in helping Lincoln save the Union.
He did.
So just talk about how that friendship sort of shaped the outcome of the Civil War and how it evolved.
Sure. So Lincoln shows up in Springfield, Illinois in 1837. He's a new lawyer. He's a beanpole of a man. He walks into the store that Joshua Speed runs, and he says, you got any bedding? Speed says, yeah, I got bedding. How much? $17. Lincoln doesn't have a penny to his name. So Speed says, walk upstairs. I have a double bed. If you like it, it's yours. So Lincoln walks up the stairs, checks out the double bed, walks back down and says, Speed, I'm moved. And for the next 4 years, they share that bed. That at the end of the 4 years, in January of 1841, Lincoln falls into a depression that is so profound that he is going to kill himself. Because Speed has told him he's moving back to Kentucky, where he's from. He owns, his father was a very wealthy slave owner and plantation owner. And Lincoln had proposed to his then fiance, Mary Todd, and then decided he didn't want to do it. And he pulled it back. And the twin events of Speed going back and Mary Todd's broken engagement puts him in his bed. Speed ministers to him for a month, takes away all of his sharp objects. And during that period, Lincoln says to Speed, you know, if I kill myself, nobody is going to know the name Abraham Lincoln. Well, Speed makes sure that everybody knows it. Fast forward 20 years, now Lincoln is the president-elect. They've conversed a little bit they've exchanged letters in the 1850s, really over the issue of slavery. They had a little bit of a falling out in the late 1840s over unpaid legal bills that Speed owed Lincoln. But in the 1850s, Lincoln starts to really hone his views on slavery. He's evolving, and he shares his views with Speed, and they have very frank, tough exchanges about the institution. And Speed is a big believer that slavery is permitted by the Constitution, and it's necessary to keep in order to preserve the Union. Lincoln obviously takes a different view, but they have respect for each other such that when Lincoln is elected, one of his first letters is to Speed to say, I need to see you right away. Speed shows up in Chicago a couple of weeks after the election, and Lincoln says to him right away, I want you in my government. Kind of like a team of rivals, you know, Doris Kearns Goodwin theme. Speed says, I'm too rich to join your government, but I'll do something better for you. I will keep Kentucky in the Union. Kentucky was one of five border states, and if Kentucky had actually seceded right before Lincoln's inauguration, likely the other four would have seceded, and I don't think the Union would have survived. Lincoln says, I'll take you up on that. He makes sure that all the weapons that were being sent to Kentucky get into the hands of Union militiamen. He makes sure that Lincoln messages about the war in a way that keeps Kentuckians believing that it's not about slavery and about preserving the Union, which was key to keeping Kentucky on the side of the Union. And at the same time, he provides this emotional support to Lincoln. He starts going up to the White House. They spend Thanksgiving together. Their friendship is really rekindled. But to your question, what is so beautiful about this friendship is that it was so strong in the 1840s, 1830s, that it resurrects itself 20 years later and has a profound influence on preserving the Union. And one thing I will say is when he writes the Emancipation Proclamation, one of the first people he shows it to is Speed. Speed's against issuing it, thinks it's too early. But after he issues it, Speed writes a Lincoln writes a letter to Speed, and he says, you know what? I was worried that nobody would know the name Abraham Lincoln. Well, you saved me, and now everybody's going to know the name Abraham Lincoln. It was kind of a really poignant reminder of how important that friendship was to both.
That's great. Okay. All right. You talked about David Ormsby Gore. Let's get into the Kennedy presidency and his impact on the Kennedy presidency.
Sure. So David Ormsby Gore was the second son of a very powerful lord named Lord Harlech. He meets John Kennedy in the summer of 1938 in pre-war London. They both like to talk fast. They both like to go to the horse races. They like to golf. And they love politics. And they just form this instant bond in 1938. The friendship blossoms as each of them rises in their respective governments. Obviously, Kennedy becomes congressman after the war, becomes a senator. Ormsby Gore is a little bit late in blossoming because the truth was when they met in the 1830s, they were both a little bit lost as to what they were going to do because they were second sons and their older brothers were supposed to become the powerful ones. Both of them lose their older brothers, one in a war, one in a car accident. So now they're each rising in their bureaucracies. And their friendship never loses a beat. They see each other whenever Kennedy goes to the United Kingdom. Ormsby Gore starts going over to the United States in the 1950s. The relationship really takes hold in 1958 when Ormsby Gore becomes a nuclear arms expert negotiating on behalf of the British with the Russians. And Kennedy seizes on that as a really important issue. And their personal friendship at the same time starts to take off. He and his wife become really, really good friends with Jack and Jackie. And in 1960, he becomes the most important foreign policy advisor during his campaign. He makes this disquieting discovery. All my advisors are too old-fashioned. I'm a new frontier kind of guy, and I need new thinking. And Gore just appealed to him. He was of his generation.
And Gore, at this point, is still in the UK government?
He's in the UK. So he's in the UK government. He's in the Ministry of State.
Yeah.
He's essentially the second, third-ranking British official in the British Foreign Service. Yeah. But he's an expert in nuclear disarmament, which really appeals to Kennedy, because he's trying to figure out how to deal with the Soviets, both in his 58 Senate campaign and then when he's running for president in 1960. And Ormsby Gore helps him kind of come up with this tough on the Russians, which is the missile gap, right? This kind of BS argument that the Americans had a missile gap with the Russians in 1960, which played very, very well for Kennedy. But at the same time, arguing that we need to do nuclear disarmament, which had never been attempted in 1960. It had just been an arms race for the prior 15 years. So they become both personal friends, and he's his closest foreign policy advisor, despite being a British official. It all kind of comes to a head in 1962. Kennedy is in Chicago. It's day 5 of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And he gets a call from his brother saying, you got to make a decision. You got to come back to Washington. The XCOM has decided we've got two options regarding these missile discoveries of Russians' missiles in Cuba. We're either going to bomb Cuba or we're going to blockade. You got to come back. So Kennedy flies back to Washington that day, and I start the chapter with this. But he issues 4 commands. And the 4th command is, I need to see David Ormsby Gore unseen at the White House the next morning. Ormsby Gore shows up. It's now day 6. And for the next 7 days, he plays a pivotal, pivotal role in helping Kennedy think through how to approach the Cuban Missile Crisis. He is there for a couple of really seminal moments, including on the Tuesday night of that week when he sits with him late at night and looks at the perimeter of the blockade and says, it's too far out. It's 800 miles. You need to bring it into 500 miles. So that the ships have more time to think about the consequences of breaking this blockade. Nobody else in the government had thought of this. Now think about this, he's now the British ambassador to the United States. I left out that's an important fact. He's the British ambassador. He has no instructions from his government, yet he says this to Kennedy because they have such an intimate friendship. And Kennedy's like, you're right. Calls up McNamara. They decide, yeah, let's move the perimeter into 500 miles. He also comes up with this brilliant way to allay fears that the missile sites didn't actually exist by releasing satellite photographs. He comes up with the idea. He writes the captions with Kennedy, identifying where the sites are. And then for the next 6 days, he is at the XCOM meetings front and center. It is so disquieting to people like Lyndon Johnson, the vice president, that he says, wait a minute, I'm sitting at the end of this table. The door is banging against my chair. And that British guy, who has no business being in this room, let alone next to the president, is right there. What's going on here? But I think there was a begrudging respect that this was a mind meld unlike any else that Kennedy had.
Clearly. All right, Richard Nixon, you mentioned B.B. Rebozo. He had this relationship, so talk about B.B. Rebozo.
Yeah. So B.B. Rebozo was about as different from Richard Nixon as two men can be. Nixon was this dark, brooding intellectual. B.B. Rebozo was a high school graduate. His first job was as a steward on Pan Am. He was ebullient. He was just a kind of happy-go-lucky guy. They meet on a houseboat that B.B. Rebozo takes Nixon out on in 1951 as a favor to a friend. Nixon sits on the boat, to your point, does not hang out with anybody on the boat. He just sits with his yellow legal pad. He's wearing like long pants, you know, button-down shirt, doesn't carouse with the group, doesn't drink, doesn't fish. And at the end, B.B. Rebozo says to his friend, never have this guy back on my boat. He's a complete dud. Nixon writes B.B. Rebozo and says, that was great. I loved it. And a friendship starts. I called John Dean, who was the White House counsel to Richard Nixon. He was a 30-year-old lawyer for Nixon. Now he's in his late 70s. And I said, did you know B.B. Rebozo? He goes, yeah, I'll tell you this funny story. He goes, the Secret Service came to me in 1970, and they said, you know, Rebozo insists on driving the boat and driving the cars whenever Nixon is with them, which was often. And that's against protocol. So we can't do that. So John Dean comes up with a compromise. He said, let's Rebozo drive the boat, and the Secret Service would drive the cars when they were together. So the Secret Service agent's on top of the boat one day in 1970, and they go out on their long journey. And he's sitting on top, and the first hour, he does not hear a word coming from the stateroom below. Not a word. So he's like, what is going on down there? So he climbs down, looks into the window, and the two men are just staring out to the sea, not saying a word. So he sits there for like another hour, and they still don't say another word. And I think that that was somewhat emblematic. And I'll tell you, John Dean then was so fascinated by this that he called the Secret Service agents who walked with Rebozo and Nixon on the beach in San Clemente. And he said, what do you hear when they take the walks on the beach? And the Secret Service agent goes, it's the damnedest thing. They don't talk. So I think what he did was he could read Nixon so well to know that when he got too dark, he could bring him back to the surface with a quip, a joke, an anecdote. He could mix a good martini. He could cook a good Cuban steak. He was always there for him. He was a big funder. He made a lot of money for Richard Nixon through real estate speculation. It all takes a really ugly turn, though. And this great friendship could have been the ballast that kept Nixon from his worst instincts when he became president, but it doesn't. And in 1969, when Richard Nixon becomes president, he enlists B.B. Rebozo in some of his most nefarious acts right from the get-go. And I think part of it was he knew that B.B. Rebozo was an ebullient guy and a lovely guy, but he was also a non-associate member of the mob and had made a lot of money through his mob connections. And so there was a side to him that he knew he could exploit for his own purposes. And so he started working on a way to get rid of Castro because he was a Cuban immigré. He worked on, the Washington Post was doing an IPO in the early 70s, and Nixon hated the Washington Post. So he asked Rebozo to kind of do everything he could to undermine their IPO. But the worst thing he did was he said, I need you to start raising campaign funds basically off the books. Mm. And the first person that he got a, quote, $100,000 campaign contribution from was Howard Hughes, the billionaire. Mm. Turns out it was a bribe. Howard Hughes had a matter before the Justice Department. B.B. Rebozo takes $100,000. He ends up giving $40,000 of it to Richard Nixon for a putting green at his house in San Clemente. You know, it's all unmarked bills that he's just basically siphoning out, gives it to Rosemary Woods. I think that that bribe slash loan slash campaign contribution is the reason why, and I write about this in my chapter, why Richard Nixon bugged the DNC in 1972. And you have to, it's a long story, I won't bore you with it, but you have to read my chapter to appreciate it. And I think there's a lot of evidence to support that. So B.B. Rebozo, not only the first friend, but the first enabler, and really the first friend to, I think, directly lead to the resignation and impeachment of a United States president.
All right, why don't we end it there? Really, thank you for spending the time with us, Gary.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And congrats on the book.
Thank you.
Terrific.